This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
A Merry Christmas to all of you at home.
The most precious thing on this earth is the human brain, and yet we allow it to die.
It is quite useless to resist, as we are stronger and more efficient than your earth people.
You belong to us. You shall be like us.
The ascension shall begin.
The strength and might of the cyber race will be confirmed.
Pay. I am by God. Pay. Pain.
Merry Christmas, everybody. I've spent the past 24 days taking a look at the mainline history of the Cybermen throughout Doctor Who's televised history. But now, we've got some loose ends to tie up, and that's all of their cameo appearances. Now, this won't take as long as it did last year for the Daleks, because, to be honest, they don't have quite the extensive catalogue of appearances as the Pepper Potts do. So, let's head back to the Black and White days, the final Black and White day to be precise, as the Second Doctor is being put on trial by his own people, the Time Lords. When making his case, the Doctor lists off some of the evils he has fought throughout the universe, such as the Daleks, the Ice Warriors, the Yeti, and of course, the Cybermen. Now we move on to the Jon Pertwee era, for the only Cyberman appearance of this era, in The Carnival of Monsters, as the Doctor and Joe Grant land on what they think is a cargo ship in the 1920s, only to discover they're inside a miniscope, a device which contains numerous other settings and also creatures such as the Ogrons, Drashigs, and the Cybermen. This miniscope is the titular Carnival of Monsters. As mentioned before in this marathon, the Cybermen did not get an actual adventure with the Third Doctor, though Big Finish have recently rectified that, but on TV, the Third Doctor did encounter them in the 20th anniversary special, The Five Doctors, and he saw them get utterly destroyed by a Ranston Warrior robot. And that's it during the classic series, though during the Wilderness years, they were one of the species summoned by the Rani to kill the Doctor in London's East End during Dimensions in Time, the 30th anniversary special. But we don't talk about that.
You're all going on a long journey. A very long journey.
But it wouldn't take long for the Cybermen to make a splash in the revived series, with a cyber helmet being found in Henry Van Staten's museum by the Ninth Doctor in the story Dalek. Interestingly, while the helmet is definitely from Revenge of the Cybermen because of the headgun and the handlebars, the museum inscription says that it was found in the London sewers, which means it came from the invasion.
Oh no, I've gone cross-eyed.
The next cameo wouldn't come for several years, the 2010 story The Pandorica Opens, but it's pretty substantial. The 11th Doctor, Amy and River Song investigate underneath Stonehenge looking for the fabled Pandorica. They descend underground only to find a severed Cyberman's arm, and there's also a cyber helmet on the surface, which uses its cables to crawl around, fires a tranquilizer at Amy through its mouth, and even rejoins its damaged body, only to be destroyed by Rory the Centurion. Side note, I love how when the arm is revealed, we get Murray Gold's Cyberman theme added to the score. Side note, Amy does not know what a Cyberman is, further emphasizing that their invasions, like an army of ghosts and the Next Doctor, had been wiped from history by the cracks in time. However, things get more serious when the Cybermen join thousands of other hostile species to claim the Pandorica, before revealing that they're actually all part of an alliance which have schemed to trap the Doctor inside, with a cyber leader and two sentries beaming down to oversee the mission. Next up in Series 6, we have A Good Man Goes to War, where the Doctor and Rory infiltrate a cyber fleet to confront the leader to see if they know anything about the location of Amy Pond, who has been kidnapped by the Silence. It's a badass cold open to the story, and it lets the audience know that the Doctor is not playing around anymore. During the show's 50th anniversary in the Day of the Doctor, while the Cybermen don't have a formal appearance, an elaborate painting of them is hanging in the undergallery behind a bust of Albert Einstein. I've done a lot of Googling, but I couldn't find any info or trivia about this painting. Are there any art experts out there? Is this a reference or a parody of something? theories on a postcard, and also I guess I'll accept them in the comment section below. In the 11th Doctor's regeneration story, The Time of the Doctor, the Cybermen are one of the species that attempts to invade Trenzalore and the town of Christmas. At one point, they send a single wooden Cyberman to infiltrate the town, with its lacking of technology not setting off any alarm signals. The Doctor tricks it into destroying itself because the sonic screwdriver does not work on wood. Eventually, once the force fields are down, the Cybermen invade proper, only to be fought off by the Doctor and the Silence, until it's only the Daleks remaining. However, it would be wrong of me to just chalk up the Cybermen's inclusion in the story to just their invasion force, because without any sort of setup or introduction, we just find the Doctor in possession of a reprogrammed cyber head who basically acts as his de facto companion for this episode, called Handles. Handles helps the Doctor identify Gallifrey, translates the Time Lord signal coming through the crack in time on Trenzalore as Doctor Who, and stays with him for the first 300 years on the planet, technically making Handles the longest serving companion in the show's history. Handles also isn't voiced by Nicholas Briggs, but by actor Kayvan Novak, and I think it says a lot for how big an impact he made in this story that his death of old age in this special had audiences crying more than most actual companion departures.
Come back.
Handles.
Thank you, Handles. And well done. Well done, mate.
The Cybermen's last cameo appearances come towards the end of Series 9, where the 12th Doctor and Clara visit a London trap street, where different aliens live in secret. One of these aliens is a Cyberman who we see being repaired by an Ood, and in the Series 9 finale, Hellbent, the Cybermen are one of several species trapped in the cloisters on Gallifrey, that the Matrix uses as a defense mechanism, along with the Weeping Angels and a Dalek that's also trapped there. That's the thing about the Cybermen's more recent cameo appearances. They're normally part of a bigger ensemble, or as an established threat that doesn't need much in the way of setup, whether it's applied to a bigger story like In Closing Time or The Next Doctor, or just a quick appearance in A Good Man Goes to War or The Time of the Doctor. They're part of the furniture, but I do think that more can be done with them than just being another villain's side attraction. But before we delve into that, let's do some rankings. I'm going to blitz through this because I've got to cook Christmas dinner. So let's get to ranking all of the televised Cybermen stories, not counting expanded media or spin-offs, and judging them as Cybermen stories first and foremost, from worst to best, from 1966 to 2020. Here we go. Number 18, Dark Water and Death in Heaven. Number 17, The Wheel in Space. Number 16, Revenge of the Cybermen. Number 15, Nightmare in Silver. Number 14, The Next Doctor. Number 13, Ascension of the Cybermen and the Timeless Children. Number 12, The Moon Base. Number 11, Army of Ghosts and Doomsday. Number 10, Silver Nemesis. Number 9, Closing Time. Number 8, Attack of the Cybermen. Number 7, Rise of the Cybermen and the Age of Steel. Number 6, The Tenth Planet. Number 5, The Haunting of Villa Diodati. Number 4, The Invasion. Number 3, World Enough in Time and the Doctor Falls. Number 2, Earthshock. And the number 1 Cyberman story is The Tomb of the Cybermen. And that's my list. I think there are some stories nearer the bottom which are better than ones higher up, but I'm talking about stories that represent the Cybermen at their best, and the stories that do them the most justice, because having watched all of their stories back to back for this marathon, I feel like a lot of them barely scratch the surface of what they're capable of as antagonists. Many of the stories get close and then lose sight in favour of a different, shinier villain, like the Master or the Daleks, but I still think there's a lot of body horror and existential questions about humanity and technology that Kit Pedler and Jerry Davis pondered almost 60 years ago. I think they're still relevant today. Last year, I briefly explained what I would do with the Daleks moving forward, so it only seems fit for me to talk about what I would do with the Cybermen. Firstly, tell a Shad's story. Not in spin-off media, don't let Big Finish bail you out of this one. Dedicate an episode in a future series to have the Ruth Doctor or someone else meet him and we explore that origin. Do that character justice. But in a what would I do as showrunner capacity, I think it would be cool to expand on or adapt a character like Croton, a Cyberman as a companion of the Doctor. There would need to be another human companion on board the TARDIS as well, but that might be a fascinating long-form story to tell. And to make the costume easy for the actor and for production, have a Cyberman from the Invasion. Nice, streamlined, and recognizable. But as for a Cyberman story proper, well, we need to explore that Ship of Theseus aspect of them, and I'm not just referring to Phones Bad, which is the logical extension of Rise of the Cybermen, more akin to the physical and mental aspect. Like people who serve in the military get limbs blown off, or are blinded or injured, and technology can be used to give them a normal life again, whether it's a prosthetic limb, or allowing them to regain their sight or their hearing. Are they Cybermen? I imagine not, but where is that line? And how do we get there? Let's reflect back to the hellscape that is 2020. These videos are made 2 months in advance, so I have no idea who won the 2020 American presidential election. But even if that outcome was relatively positive, the 10 months leading up to it have been pretty terrible. Obvious corruption, government incompetence, the neglecting of their duty of care to protect people from a pandemic, people in the streets being attacked and even killed by the police who are supposed to protect them, and there's very little change in sight. A population relegated to doom scrolling on Twitter, and even when they can vote, their vote is either suppressed or the wants of the majority are ignored. The people in power know the bubble will burst, but what can they do to control the population? Okay, the leaders say. We disenfranchise you, we force you into poverty, we don't let you flourish, we steal what little you have to line our pockets. We will lie to turn you against yourselves and scapegoat the most vulnerable and marginalized, and sometimes, just because we feel like it, we will kill you in the streets. Aren't you depressed? Aren't you upset? Aren't you hurt? Well, don't worry, because we can make that pain go away. That, I think, is how you bring the Cybermen into the 21st century. The Montassians converted themselves in order to physically survive, but maybe humanity can choose conversion so they mentally can cope, so they can't feel the boot on their necks anymore. And while you may think that's a bit too on the nose, keep in mind that you don't need to tell a story like this on contemporary Earth. In the history of Doctor Who, I can't think of a single other villain whose premise has been so reliant on twin planets, parallel worlds, or divergent timelines than the Cybermen. Them holding a horrifying silver mirror up to the face of humanity is entirely in keeping with their origins. And on that cheery note, happy Cybercember, everybody. I'll see you all next time.
Excellent.